At the outset, we request you, please subscribe to this channel. It will be a great way of supporting us. We have concluded the previous fifth episode with a question. And the question was, if chitta vritti or the preoccupation of the mind through the senses is the cause that is obscuring our true nature, which indeed has to be controlled, what is the nature of this chitta vritti? Can we count them? Can we classify them so that we can be aware of them in our day-to-day interactions? As a result, we would be in a better position to restrain them. In answer to this question, Sage Patanjali provides a clear-cut classification of the chitta vrittis, thus, pramana viparyaya vikalpa nidra smritaya. Pramana viparyaya vikalpa nidra smritaya. As usual, let us learn the constituents of this sutram. Pramanam viparyayaha vikalpaha nidra and smriti are the constituent words in this sutram. Thus, the sutram is a compound of these five words. That is the reason for its plural ending as smritayah. In brief, pramanam means perception or correct notion or true and indisputable knowledge. Viparyayah means wrong knowledge or false notion or untrue and uncertain knowledge. Vikalpah means doubt or uncertainty or fancy. Nidra means deep sleep and smriti means memory. Let us see them in detail, one after another, beginning with pramanam. Generally, the word pramanam is used to refer to a testimony or an evidence or a proof. And this general notion is not so far from the textual definition in the context of yoga philosophy. Nevertheless, a fine description of the word pramanam would be undisputed knowledge of the external worldly objects with the chitta or the mind through sense contact. The word prama in pramanam refers to true knowledge. Hence, pramakaranam or that which causes or facilitates prama or true knowledge is said to be pramanam. Otherwise, the means of true knowledge or the process of obtaining correct knowledge is pramanam. What is that? It's nothing but the contact of the sense organs with the sense objects when prompted by the mind. Nevertheless, yoga philosophy emphasizes that this is only a conventional practice by the worldly minded people who do not possess awareness regarding the reality behind the apparent existence. For existence and things in this world are only phenomenal and not real. Now, if pramanam is undisputed knowledge of the external worldly objects with the chitta or the mind through sense contact, what about knowledge acquired even without any direct contact of the senses with sense objects? For example, when we hear a sound, we guess what is happening even without seeing the event. And such knowledge is true. Just listening to someone's footsteps, we foresee the approaching person even without seeing him. Mere smell without seeing the object helps us conclude its source. Are they not right knowledge? To address all such possible doubts, Patanjali provides a precise definition of pramanam in his next sutram as pratyakshanumanagamah pramanani. Pratyaksha anumana agamah pramanani. And let us find out the constituent words of this sutram. Pratyaksham, anumanam and agamah are the constituents. Thus, the sutram is a compound of these three words, That is the reason for its plural ending as pramanani. Please note that pramanam is used by all the schools of Indian philosophy to provide their hypothesis. Nevertheless, as most of the philosophical schools differ in their doctrine, the use of pramanas won't be similar. For example, besides these three pramanas, the logic or nyaya school uses upamanam or analogy as one of their pramanas. In the same way, it is different for other schools of philosophy. Let us keep that aside and look into each of these three pramanas in a little detail, beginning with pratyaksham. Pratyaksham is perception or right knowledge born out of experience through contact of the senses with sense objects. For example, we see a flower. Its specific shape, its class, its general nature, its qualities, etc. Similarly, through sound, taste, touch and smell, we understand the worldly things. At times, even after having sense contact, we may not get definite knowledge due to the seer's unfamiliarity with the object of the sense or by extraneous reasons. As a result, there may not be a clear understanding of the object with its name, form or functionality. Now, there is a widespread misunderstanding regarding the word pratyaksham. Many of us mistake the word pratyaksham for only something visible. This misunderstanding is due to our familiarity with the word akshi, which means the eye. But in pratyaksham, the word is aksham, that refers to the sense organ in general. When added with the prefix prati, it refers to every sense organ. For example, pratidinam means every day, pratidesham in every country, pratideham in every body, pratipadam at every step, prativarsham every year, etc. Similarly, prati aksham is pratyaksham, means every sense organ. Therefore, the word pratyaksham refers to all the sense organs and everything subject to the sense organs. So in short, pratyaksham is one of the pramanas by which a seer or a person understands things that become the subject of any of his senses. And this is a chitta vritti that restricts the seer from seeing his true nature. So, among the five chitta vrittis, the first one is pramanam, which is of three types, namely pratyaksham, anumanam and agama, among which we have seen what pratyaksham is. Next is anumanam. Anumanam is inference, born out of consideration or judgment. Otherwise, ascertaining something from a perceived mark or sign is anumanam. For example, ascertaining the presence of fire looking at smoke is anumanam, because we have seen numerous times the coexistence of fire and smoke, as a result of which we have conceived a general notion that if there is smoke, then there must be fire. Another example given by the philosophers is that the movement of celestial bodies are ascertained based on their location at different times seen from different places. In short, anumanam is one of the pramanas by which a seer or a person understands things that once became the subject of any of his senses. And this is another chitta vritti that restricts the seer from seeing his true nature. So, among the five chitta vrittis, the first one is pramanam, which has three divisions, namely pratyaksham, anumanam and agama, among which we have seen both pratyaksham and anumanam. Next is agama. Agama is also known as aptavachanam. It means tradition or verbal testimony or knowledge born out of an authority or dependable or trustworthy verbal source such as an authentic text or a person who has realized the truth either by perception or inference. Realization of the truth is said to be aptihi. It arises from direct perception or inference in the light of perceived knowledge. One who has aptihi is apta. The vachana or testimony of apta is known as apta vachanam, which becomes a means of knowledge for others who have not directly realized the truth. For example, the concept of heaven and hell or life after death, the results of virtue and vices, etc., advocated by such men. We haven't seen them. Even those men who talk or write about such things are mortal humans like us. Yet, considering the trustworthiness of them, we accept such verbal testimony as authentic and keep brooding over such phenomena. This is yet another chitta vritti that restricts the seer from seeing his true nature. So, out of the five chitta vrittis, we have learned the first one, namely pramanam, which is of three types, pratyaksham, anumanam and agamaha. Our mind, through the senses, either directly or by inference or by testimony, remain constantly engaged in perceiving the world and its phenomena. The result is that we remain quite oblivious of our true nature. The second kind of chitta vritti is viparyayaha. Patanjali defines it as viparyayo mithyajnanam atadrupa pratishtam. Viparyayaha mithyajnanam atadrupa pratishtam are its constituents. Viparyaya is mithyajnanam or false knowledge. What kind of mithyajnanam or false knowledge? Atadrupa pratishtam. So what is atadrupa pratishtam? For ease of understanding, let us learn one more word. Tadrupa pratishtam, and then differentiate between tadrupa pratishtam and atadrupa pratishtam. Please remember, the word tadrupa pratishtam is not there in this sutram. The word in the sutram is atadrupa pratishtam. One is the complete opposite of the other. Therefore, a comparison of these two words will give us better understanding of what atadrupa pratishtam stands for. So, tadrupa pratishtam means understanding or knowledge based on something or a substratum. For example, the knowledge of a flower is based on the flower. The flower is the substratum for the knowledge of the flower, without which we cannot understand what a flower is. Similarly, the knowledge of a mirror is based on the mirror. The mirror is the substratum for the knowledge of a mirror, without which we cannot understand what a mirror is. In the same way, knowledge of a silver plate is based on a piece of silver. The silver is the objective substratum for the knowledge of silver, without which we cannot understand what silver is. If so, what is atadrupa pratishtam? Understanding or knowledge not based on something or a substratum is atadrupa pratishtam. Or mistaken knowledge of an object which actually is not that. Or understanding something as something else is atadrupa pratishtam. For example, we see a piece of mirror on a sunny day at a distance and think it a piece of silver. Or mistaking a conch shell for a piece of silver. Neither the appearance is true nor the actual object is revealed. This is viparyaya. So, viparyayaha means wrong knowledge or false notion or untrue and uncertain knowledge. It is similar to doubt as proposed by the logicians, but not exactly it, because in doubt we tend to doubt the presence of something as something else by similarity in appearance, just as in the case of doubting a stump of wood as a person in standing position. Whereas in viparyaya, there is a complete misunderstanding. Yet, yoga includes doubt also in this category. So, for pramana, we have perception or engagement of the mind through the senses with sense objects. Whereas in viparyaya, we hold untrue and uncertain knowledge. So, viparyaya is yet another chitta vritti that restricts the seer from seeing his true nature. The third kind of chitta vritti is vikalpa. Patanjali defines it as shabda jnana anupati vastu shunyo vikalpa. In simple words, vikalpa is uncertain knowledge about something as a result of following what has been said about something else. Let us see its constituents for a better understanding. Shabda jnana anupati, vastu shunyaha and vikalpaha. Shabda jnanam anupatati or anugachati iti shabda jnana anupati. Then what is shabda jnanam? Shabda janyam jnanam shabda jnanam, which means following after word knowledge or verbal knowledge. What is vastu shunya? Vastu means something that exists in reality. Vastu shunya means not really existing, or better said, empty of substance. For example, let us consider the sentence, the house of Mr. Rama. From this statement, we understand the connection between the house and Mr. Rama. The house belongs to him. He is its owner. Though the house and Mr. Rama are two different entities. Now take another similar sentence, the life of Mr. Rama. After hearing this sentence, if we come to the conclusion that the life and Mr. Rama are two different entities, just as the house and Rama were different, it is called vikalpaha in yogic parlance. There is no substance in such a conclusion, because in the first sentence there is a clear demarcation, whereas in the second there is no such demarcation. For Mr. Rama and his life are not different. As such, such a conclusion is not certain or true, because the reference is made to the same entity. The relationship conveyed through the first and the second sentences are different. For in the first sentence, there is a separable connection, whereas in the second, the connection is inseparable. In fact, it is just convention to use such a verbal relationship which is not actually there. Otherwise, the true nature of Mr. Rama and his life are not different. A reference to the body of Mr. Rama is only a convention, not reality. So, for pramana, we have perception or engagement of the mind through the senses with sense objects. Whereas in viparyaya, we hold untrue and uncertain knowledge. And in vikalpa, we hold knowledge of something based on verbal expressions. The fourth kind of chitta vritti is nidra. Nidra is the deep sleep state of the mind. Sage Patanjali defines nidra as abhava pratyayalambana vrittir nidra. Abhava pratyayalambana vrittir nidra. Let us see the constituent words for a better understanding. Abhava pratyayalambana vritti and nidra are the two constituents in this sutram between which abhava pratyayalambana vrittihi is a compound that qualifies nidra. Abhava means absence. Pratyaya means knowledge or cognition. Please note that the word pratyaya is used in grammar to refer to suffixes, which is not meant here. Then, alambana means to depend on or to rely on as a substratum. Vritti refers to chitta vritti, which means the activities or engagements or preoccupations of the chitta or the mind. Therefore, nidra or deep sleep is the chitta vritti or the state of the mind which has for its substratum nothingness. Now there is a doubt. How can it be considered a chitta vritti? Because chitta vritti means the preoccupation or engagement of the mind through the sense organs. In sleep, we don't see engagement of any of the senses. Please recall that we have learned a few things about the mind in the third episode. Now, the mind has numerous roles to play. For experiencing the external world, it prompts the external sense organs such as the eyes, the ears, the nose, the tongue and the skin to get in touch or to get in contact with the objects of the senses to understand them by their form, sound, smell, taste and touch. But for the internal experience in deep sleep, there is no direct engagement of these sense organs. And here, in the state of nidra or deep sleep, the mind plays the role of the internal sense organ. Thus, sleep does not mean complete inactivity, as a few among us tend to mistake. The difference thus is that the external sense organs remain withdrawn from the external worldly objects, and the mind, now in the role of the internal sense organ, experiences the quietude of nothingness. As a result, after a good night's sleep, we say, "Oh, I slept well." This recollection, this memory of sound sleep would not be possible without experience, because memory is nothing but the impression of the past experiences. Thus, nidra is a chitta vritti that restricts the seer from seeing his true nature. And the fifth and final chitta vritti is smritihi, which means remembrance or memory. Patanjali defines smritihi as anubhuta vishaya sampramosha smritihi. Let us see the constituent words for a better understanding. Anubhuta vishaya sampramoshaha and smritihi are the words in it. Between these two, anubhuta vishaya sampramoshaha is a compound of anubhuta, vishaya and asampramosha. Anubhuta means experienced or felt or understood or known. Vishaya means the things or objects or events, etc. of such experiences. Asampramosha means not letting go or not allowing to escape or to retain or to keep hold of. And now, let us try to combine one after another to bring out the complete meaning. Anubhuta vishaya means things or objects or events we have experienced, or better say, our past experiences of all kinds. It could be a beautiful flower that we have seen, or a piece of melodious music that we have heard, or an enlightening lecture that we have listened to, or a piece of sweet that we have tasted. The experience is over, but the impressions that experience has created in our brain remains. This is anubhuta vishaya. Now, not letting those impressions go or not allowing those impressions to escape, in other words, to retain or to keep hold of such impressions is asampramosha. So, remembrance or memory is nothing but retaining impressions of past experiences. Every memory is the result of experiencing the fivefold chitta vrittis that we have learned in the beginning of this episode as pramana viparyaya vikalpa nidra smrutaya. Therefore, the clarity, correctness and veracity of our memory is totally dependent on the kind of our experiences. For example, if our cognition or knowledge gained through experience is true, then the memory arising from it would be true. If we had a blurred experience of an event, then it would be difficult to recap the sequence of such an event. So, let us sum up what we have learned so far. We have learned that yoga is chitta vritti nirodha, which means completely retracting the mind from being engaged through the senses. And chitta vrittis are fivefold, namely pramana, viparyaya, vikalpa, nidra and smriti. Restraining these chitta vrittis take us to the state of yoga that helps us see our true nature. And now there is a question. How do we do this chitta vritti nirodha? Sage Patanjali begins explaining it with the sutram Abhyasa Vairagyabhyam Tannirodha. Let us learn this in the next episode. Please stay tuned by subscribing to this channel. Your subscriptions will be a great help and encouragement. Also, please share it among your friends.